Which direction am I going? Okay, I think I've got that now. My name's Jeanine. I'm from IBM locally here. I've been in the area for about 20 years and spent my life on the information technology side, not the biotech or biomedical side. So my perspective is much different than some of our other panelists. I am primarily information technology and electronics technology, where my whole perspective is more from a licensing and commercialization rather than an exclusionary principle. The options that we see most often and that IBM is very involved in addition to just normal patent protection and licensing, are the prospects of patent pools, patent pledges. IBM has pledged, we started out with 500 patents to the open source community in defense of open source software so they could move forward. Patent pledges with respect to interoperability specifications and interoperability standards to try and break down those barriers for allowing people to work together and to interoperate. We also have standards organizations which have compulsory licensing if you want to join the standard or utilize the standards body. There are patent pools, as were mentioned before, as well as the patent commons. And my purpose here today is to speak primarily about the patent commons that IBM is involved in. It's called the Eco-Patent Commons. It is actually sponsored by the World Business Council for Sustainable Development, but it was jointly created by the World Business Council and IBM, Nokia, Pitney Bowes, and Sony. Since that point in time, back in 2008, beginning of 2008, end of 2007, that it was created, we've had several other companies join the patent commons. It started with just a few patents and is currently up to 100 patents. Several companies have also expressed interest in joining this patent commons, and I will discuss a little bit more what the patent commons is and what it isn't in the next couple slides. It really is an opportunity for business leadership to invest and show what technology it has. It's not really intended to be the core technology of any of the contributors, but to donate technology to help facilitate and grow collaboration and also to facilitate growth in areas that are maybe not the core business that you want to continue forward with, but that you may benefit from in the long run. It's the basic rule of a patent to be given to or pledged to the commons is that it must have a beneficial environmental effect. That took a long time to try and figure out what that meant. A beneficial environmental effect is determined, of course, by something that would reduce carbon emissions, but also that would reduce waste, reduce contamination. And the World Business Council and its group of founding members have gone through the patent categorizations and classifications of patents and determined which subclasses they believe patents would fall into that meet these requirements. So if a company wants to join the Commons and donate a patent or pledge a patent to the Commons right now, they have to have a patent that falls within one of these subclasses, and I've got examples later on, that will provide an environmentally beneficial impact to society. There is a petition ability if you believe there's a patent that's not in one of these subclasses that should be added. There are petition abilities. But the patents are pledged. They're made available for use by anyone free of charge, but there is a defensive termination provision in the use agreement. So that, and it, the defensive termination provisions are dependent upon whether you are a member of the Commons or if you are not a member of the Commons. Anyone worldwide can use a pledged patent of the Commons freely without any royalty as long as they do not sue the owner of that patent for patent infringement. If they sue the owner of the patent for patent infringement, they will lose their license. If you're a member of the Commons and you sue another member of the Commons for patent infringement, unless it is a patent covered by the Commons, you do not lose your license. So if you are using patents on water purification from the Commons and you sue another member of the Commons on production of photocells, but it was not in the Commons, then you don't lose your license. So that is one reason to go into a Commons or a license type scenario versus a true pledge or compulsory maneuver. The premise of this is that sharing patents is a way to be a good corporate citizen, a good environmental citizen, and lead the way while the world figures out how we're actually going to improve the environment. It addresses a wide range of challenges and promotes efficiency in the sustainable development. As I think we've heard multiple times over here, you need economic basis and revenue-generating bases in order to promote investment in innovation that's actually going to achieve the results we want. And the members of EcoPatents Common really believe that this is a step in the right direction of continuing economic investment, still rewarding people for their innovations, but allowing them to share innovations that may not be their key or their core, and still protect their own rights if a misdoer comes in. As I said, the patents need to provide an environmental benefit. And most of the patents donated to the, or pledged to the Commons are not the core business of the company donating them. I will show you some that I'm not so sure they aren't the core business, but people are not encouraged or pushed to try and donate the crown jewels. The benefits for the member companies, it shows them and demonstrates to them more innovation, gives them a free license to areas that they may just want to be getting into, that they want to try and expand to. It can facilitate collaboration and new business opportunities. One thing that this Commons does not cover yet that other organizations do and that's being looked into is it does not cover trade secrets or copyright. This purely covers the patents at the time, and it is being looked into for broadening, but there are some challenges there as to how to define what is environmentally beneficial. the people who do join the Commons, when they pledge their patent, they put up information and a description on the World Business Council for Sustainable Development's website. And that can provide additional information, some of the technology and background necessary for people to actually implement this or embody this. So there is the ability to share through the Eco Patents Common, but it is not something where someone can come in at this point and donate a trade secret and become a member. You have to have a patent on an eco-friendly technology to become a member. And as I said, it does have this defensive termination provision that makes people, or encourages companies to contribute who want to and become take the benefits of being a good corporate citizen, but also not completely expose themselves to others who want to come after them. The benefits for users, of course, are free access to patents, additional information. They can identify people they want to, networking in people they want to work with and come in contact with, and it enables a participant to sustain development. If companies are, or even individuals for that matter, but if someone holding a patent, some entity holding a patent, is interested in joining the Commons, they contact a representative and their intellectual property organization. And there is information on the World Business Council for Software Development website. Even one patent is sufficient for participation. As I said, to date, there are 100 patents that are in the Eco Patent Commons system. I believe we've got 11 members now. Some of these, just examples of things that are being donated. These are the most highly utilized patents out of the Eco Patents Commons, and some of them are from my employer, IBM, and some from others. IBM has one for ozone generation to help reduce harmful emissions while sterilizing and cleaning. There is some things as somewhat obvious or simple as reducing landfill waste and toxic glues by utilizing a corrugated cardboard or compressive cardboard packaging applications instead of the styrofoam and blown-in foam. Catalytic reactor. To help clean in the fabrication process for semiconductors. Here's one donated by Sony for wastewater purification and wastewater treatment. Nokia is methods of recycling cell phones into other usable components. Pitney Bowes and inkjet printers and reduction of waste and ink utilization, and those are just a few. Those are three contacts that we have, a couple at IBM and one at the World Business Council for Sustainable Development for if anyone is interested in further information. As I said, the website is World Business Council for Sustainable Development, WBCSD.org. Thank you.
Well, good morning. First, I want to thank the organizers for the very kind invitation, Travis Buchanan and the Society, and Jerry Reichman and Duke. It's a great pleasure to be here. For those of you watching this on the webcast, the six of you who are doing that, I know that Tiger Woods is getting ready to talk about extramarital sex and money, and I want to assure you that my presentation will be more interesting than that. I would also just start by noting that this is the annual conference on hot topics and intellectual property, and what I'm not talking about today, but which I think will be one of the hot topics of intellectual property this year, I am serving as co-counsel for the Indian government in the matter of generic pharmaceuticals in transit and their seizure under the European Union IP border regulation, and I expect that we will file a request for consultations within the next few weeks. This is a very interesting subject matter involving the extension of local patents in the Netherlands to seize otherwise unpatented drugs moving between countries like India and Brazil, or India and Nigeria. Some very deep and problematic questions involving the relationship between free transit of goods and the regulatory rights of national jurisdiction based on patent law. And so for those of you, particularly students who are interested in hot topics for 2010, I expect this will be one of them. I'd be happy to discuss that during the question and answer if anyone's interested in it. What I'm going to do today, and hopefully I will figure out which one of these is the is talk about several different aspects of work. I had advised the developing country group from the inception of the Doha Declaration negotiations and their conclusion, and then through the paragraph 6 negotiations on compulsory licensing for export, and subsequently, as Jerry mentioned, also quite actively involved in the implementation effort, including the report Jerry and I did for the European Parliament on whether or not to ratify the Article 31b's amendment. And out of that, the folks at the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development thought it would be interesting to try to take a look at what we had learned from 8 to 10 years of negotiations in public health and what relevance that might have for the climate change negotiations. And that resulted in a paper, and I'll talk a little bit about some of the conclusions from that and some of the slides from a presentation on that, but I'm not the type of person who would present the same slide presentation twice. So what I'm bringing into this today is also, for the past year, I've been working for the WHO Secretariat for Public Health Innovation and Intellectual Property on a study of transfer of technology in the pharmaceutical sector, particularly in relation to the local production of medicines, vaccines, and diagnostics, and conducted a wide-ranging stakeholder survey among stakeholders in the industry on their attitudes towards transfer of technology and local production. And just to reflect again a little bit about what that might say about the climate change situation and climate change negotiations. I suppose I should start by noting that most of the things that I'm going to say have already been said in one way or another, and I largely concur with the general assessment of the international negotiating environment that Jennifer Haverkamp started us out with this morning. Now, when we started just looking at negotiations, and in this context, really from the standpoint of developing countries, the question was, when you're approaching the UNFCCC negotiations, You know, how are you going to succeed? And again, I'll start by noting that I wouldn't consider the public health negotiations a categorical success. They did have several major success points, for example, the Doha Declaration, but more broadly changing the international perspective on attitudes about needing to address public issues and the net consequences of those negotiations have resulted in a fairly dramatic increase in the number of patients under treatment for HIV/AIDS in Africa and elsewhere. So whether you look at it from an intellectual property standpoint or more a global government and public perception standpoint, I think the negotiations had some significant success. But what did they teach us about negotiating? Well, I'm sure Jennifer Haverkamp has enough experience to come up with these same conclusions by themselves, none of which are particularly remarkable. The first one is that economic and political power matters. And I like to say about that, the fact that it's obvious doesn't mean that it's not true. No matter how hard Ecuador bargains, it's not going to out-negotiate the United States. And this is just the main fact of life you start out with in an international negotiation. It matters what piece you're playing on the chessboard. What developing countries were very successful at in the public health negotiations was forming strategic alliances, which substantially strengthened their bargaining position. We don't really see that, I think, so much in the climate negotiations yet. And the other thing was, don't discount external factors shaping your environment. And so, for example, Ms. Haverkamp noted this morning that we went from being in 2007 to a booming global economy, which governments might be happy to talk about giving money away. In 2010, 2011, you're not finding very many governments that are happy to discuss giving money away. A major change in the international negotiating environment is stakeholder involvement. Of course, the environmental movement is very familiar with this. Really, the environmental movement may have established the paradigm back in the late 80s and early 90s in the Rio negotiations, but that was certainly a critical lesson of the public health negotiations. I'll step through these quickly because I just want to spend a few minutes and really talk about the more recent work. We don't have very much success making zero-sum demands. You can't appeal to the multinational business community to think about equity between have and have-not countries. They're not terribly interested. Businesses are really focusing on making money, which is what they should be doing. And you need to make your appeals to what the business community thinks it might accomplish. Technology transfer requires concrete mechanisms. This is a lesson repeated over and over again. We have many international agreements that say we will get together in the future and discuss some very promising ideas about technology transfer. And as Keith Maskus and Ruth Akeji recently confirmed, you can't come up with a single example where that has actually happened. I might come back to that. Finally, just quickly, very important for the communicators to shape the political environment. You can influence media campaigns. A big lesson we noted with multilateral negotiations is that the successful operators, particularly the United States, are able to take a loss in a multilateral forum and to shift it to a gain in a bilateral forum. So even if you think you've won a multilateral negotiation, it's not over till it's over. The competition law is heavily underemployed in the area of capacity building, and that human rights do shape this whole dialogue and played a major role in the Doha negotiations. Well, how might we have transposed those to climate change? Well, first, and now a great deal of work has been done on that, is you really needed to, and one thing I cautioned heavily against was assuming that public health and climate change were the same thing. And we've heard several presentations already this morning discussing the differentiation. In fact, the business community was very proactive about this. The first out of the box was the General Counsel of General Electric, who pretty much literally said, don't paint GE with the brush of a pharmaceutical company, and recognizing the baggage that had come on to multinational industry and making the case for differentiation. Well, as has been pointed out several times today already, there really are differences. Energy really comes in two forms, electric power and combustion. And there are many ways to generate electric power, and there are many ways to generate combustion. If you try to price too high in either of those areas, competitors will enter the markets with substitute supplies. There's very few single bottleneck technologies and so forth. So there's quite a few differences that distinguish the pharmaceutical sector, where one or two key patents can prevent the treatment of an entire therapeutic class. So they really are apples and oranges comparisons. So we wanted to identify concretely the potential bottlenecks and mechanisms to solve them, and also to point out that as one ground was that one of the consequences was of the whole public health dialogue, was to show just how many weapons there are in the arsenal to address problems with intellectual property bottlenecks. And Jerry addressed any number of them. Our first speaker talked about that. Jeanine talked about some interesting work that IBM and others are doing in this area. So there's a lot of ways to address these things. Let me skip over that. Well, what did Copenhagen show us? Well, for those of us who are working a lot in multilateral negotiating forums, Copenhagen basically confirmed what we already know. That is, the multilateral negotiating system is broken, with the exception of really the Doha Amendment. We haven't had a single successful conclusion of a broad-scale multilateral negotiation in the past 7 or 8 years. There's a lot of reasons for that, but I think that in climate change, we are likely to see some very heavy negotiating, but we're going to see it in bilateral negotiations between U.S., India, Brazil, the EU and China, and so forth, where there are reciprocal concessions likely to be able to be made. In particular, I think our threats of imposing border carbon tax adjustments are going to put some pressure on other countries to negotiate more seriously on climate change issues. The international business community is perfectly content with nothing happening. There are significant business opportunities for business in the whole climate change area. It's a major opportunity, but I'm not sure what exactly the business community thinks they might get out of a decision from the UNFCCC. And that public interest in these negotiations, or at least the needs of development, wanes when it's at the risk of taking a developed country job. And that substantially changes what you're looking at. So as I mentioned, I just finished a year of study of the pharmaceutical sector, which actually followed a broad-based study for the U.S. and Colombian governments on technology transfer in the pharmaceutical sector. And what did I/we see going on in the pharmaceutical sector? And I would say that study basically confirms most of what we've been discussing here this morning. Number one is that it's very interesting to talk about what governments may or may not do, but as a practical matter, commercially useful pharmaceutical technology is largely owned and controlled by the private sector. And addressing your instructions to governments in or out of multilateral forums has only a marginal impact on what the private sector is doing. If you look at the pharmaceutical industry and you talk about technology transfer, well, there's a tremendous amount going on, in particular within the large-scale multinational enterprises, which are spending vast amounts of money establishing the OECD companies, establishing R&D facilities in China and India. Novartis recently announced a $1 billion incremental investment in an R&D facility in China which that single investment outstrips the R&D budgets of virtually every developing country in the world. And that's, you know, one private sector investment in one country, but employing a lot of Chinese R&D talent. You also have a lot of transfer of technology and outsourcing, joint product development, very largely in the process area, and a point which has been mentioned several times, but really comes home to you when you tour the operations in these countries, is that the capacity of developing countries is widely, I might even have said wildly, differentiated. India is likely to be an exporter of production process technology, not an importer. When you visit Brazil, China, India, and look at what they're doing in pharmaceuticals, they've got major investments in education, technology infrastructure, industrial policy, and all of those policies are designed to compete with the United States and the European Union in value-added products. This leads one to a conclusion, really, that what we'll see over the coming decade is an increase in the disparity in technological development between developing countries, not just between developed and developing countries. We're really moving into a much more nuanced, tiered environment. And insofar as we need to think about these things from a multilateral standpoint, there's a lot of private money going into technology in these major emerging market developing countries, and it's not something that really requires much transfer or even of financial assistance from the developed countries. Whereas, to contrast, if you go to Africa and speak with African producers, they're in a dreadful state. They have very high capital costs, weak infrastructure, relatively weak technical education capacity. Some progress is made, but it's sometimes slow and sporadic. Multilateral institutions actually sometimes engage in behaviors that end up harming local producers. For example, the WHO pre-qualification program, designed to make sure that people were getting AIDS drugs in India from India that met stringent regulatory standards, had the intended, I would say unintended, consequence of putting many African local producers out of business because they're unable to meet those qualifications. So you do things to help one group and you injure another. Certainly for Africa, you're going to need external funding sources to subsidize a transition. And then you have a significant basket of developing countries that fall between China, India, and Brazil, and perhaps South Africa on the one hand, and sub-Saharan Africa on the other. And these are the countries that, you know, of East Asia and Central America and much of Latin America and so forth, where those companies, to be competitive, really need to start thinking about generating scale economies so they can compete globally, creating regional regulatory structures to overcome the inefficiencies they've currently got working. And just to note that in virtually all of these countries, these middle ground countries, private sector investment in R&D tends to be very low. They do not see themselves in a position to play catch up with the OECD or the major emerging market countries. Keith Maskus and Ruth Akeji just did a very good paper. It's fairly similar in conclusions to the paper that Jerry and others did for the Chatham House, and basically coming to the conclusion that IPR's policy is likely to play only a modest role in the development and diffusion of climate change technologies, that really government industrial policies are going to be a much more significant factor in determining the direction and rate of investment in technical solutions, and suggesting that competition policies, again, are going to be a key instrument to preventing market distortions. Again, you know, based on what you've already heard, I'm summarizing things that I think are now fairly obvious to most players in this game, and that is that the private sector in both the developed and developing countries is going to play the predominant role in finding and implementing technical solutions, so that national government should focus on policies that encourage cross-licensing, joint ventures, and other mechanisms. Of course, then the question is, you know, the private sector does respond to government incentives if you hold out a big tax break or, you know, a major financing incentive, the private sector responds, but that presumes intelligent government planning. And as we know, that sometimes might seem like an oxymoron. But one thing that comes at looking at the state of play in technology today is that you do have very significant cases of market failure. The smaller developing countries and least developed countries really do not have the capital, either financial or human, to participate in the technical solutions that I've been talking about. And this is an area where we really do need multilateral funding and affirmative transfers if we are going to catch those folks up. And finally, confirming, I think, what has been said repeatedly today already, that IPR's flexibilities are going to play a role, but that can't cure the major market failures that are based on capital limitations. Will only play a marginal role. So that's my talk, rambling though it was, and look forward to further discussion. Thanks.
Thank you. I'd like to open this up for questions, and I have one for Jeanine. I was wondering if you have any sense with the IBM patent pool that other companies have joined as well, if the members file fewer patents after they've joined such a pool, or how does that?
Absolutely not. Mm-hmm. We have not seen the reduction within IBM nor any of the major players so far, although, you know, from a U.S. perspective, budget cuts have hit everyone, and everyone is filing less last year than potentially the years before. What it does is it gives them the opportunity to file improvement patents, as was mentioned, or related patents that would actually get greater adoption. If you give two or three patents to the pool in an area that is very interesting to you, you can get greater adoption and then patent around the periphery, okay, should you choose to do that.
Okay. And how do you decide then which patents get contributed to the pool?
Normally, it is a one-by-one decision. Is this key to our business? Is this core to our business? Is this something that makes sense that the world could make a better use of and utilization of than we could, and we could still benefit by them doing that and us getting other side benefits? Mm-hmm.
Are there...
On that same subject, IBM had all these information patents, and at a certain point, they just said, "Okay, you can use what you want, 5% across the board," and that was very successful. It's when they switched their intellectual property policy when the new management came in, and I just wish you would consider talking to them about opening a second tier. It's great if they wanted to send the more of these patents that they give for totally humanitarian reasons or because they're business method patents of dubious value, whatever reason. But there's lots of other stuff that is not producing what it might produce, and they might consider just making them available on a straight 5%, 4%, anybody in the world, same deal, don't sue us, we kill you, and just see how it works. It could be a wonderful opportunity to experiment now at the beginning stage, to ways in which you could really generate lottery effects with these early patents that really often outweigh the benefits that you would get, especially if we start getting some of these upstream patents that may be affecting research. I would urge you to just consider, since they're in a, they are in a different framework. I mean, I think Fred's point, they are in a different frame of mind. They don't want to be tarred by this brush. Yes. And I think it's a logical next step. And they might find that instead of 100 patents, they might have 300-400 patents that people are willing to put up there. Okay, take them 5%, see what happens.
So the Green Exchange is taking a little bit more of that approach, and that they have these standardized licenses, but you can have a royalty, you can license only within certain fields of use, and otherwise customize the standard license, or you can contribute patents based on your own in-house standard license. So although it's more complicated and there's more transaction costs, it adds more flexibility. So, I mean, there's a trade-off there.
Okay. In the back?
We're missing, like, the basic concept of how the compulsory license works. Like, who decides? Is it a defense to patent infringement that some technology is, you know, for the benefit of the world? I mean, has that been decided? Like, who decides that what technology should be compulsory?
You've got at least three or four experts here on the question.
Fred, you go ahead. Why don't you go ahead?
Well, it is ultimately a decision by government authority as to who is entitled or under what circumstances a compulsory license should be granted. But and any government in the world can grant a compulsory license, and any government in the world can grant a compulsory license, quote, on the grounds of its own choosing, close quote. There's no limitations. What the TRIPS agreement established was a series of steps that a government must consider when issuing a compulsory license. That licenses must be considered on their individual merits. There must be prior negotiation in the context of a commercial license prior to its issuance. In circumstances of national emergency, extreme urgency, or public non-commercial use, prior negotiation. But
in like the practical aspect of this with the climate change, you know, like the post-Copenhagen, that's what I mean. I understand what's happening with TRIPS, but like, how is there going to be like one? I guess my question is not that clear.
Your question is, would there be a
how is this going to work?
Well, I mean,
please go ahead.
Well, no, it often comes up in refusals to deal. You had the Italian Competition Commission issued three compulsory licenses on medicine recently because they refused to deal. And we've had a lot of, we had some cases with Brazil and Thailand about which Fred and I wrote, it becomes a negotiating tactic between the government and the company as to whether they will reduce the price or make it available on other terms and conditions or not. The problem is you have to have an alternative available. That is, you have to have either a local manufacturer who can substitute the technology and break the patent, or a foreign supplier who, either because it's a parallel export or because it's not patented in that country, who will supply it once the compulsory license opens the market to other competitors. That's the problem.
I think your question is there in contemplation some kind of global facility that will be making decisions about granting?
Who's monitoring this? And who, like, the country-by-country basis, is someone just deciding, we need to use that technology? Because the idea of, you know, if I'm a company in the United States, I mean, am I really going to have patents in all of these non-developed countries that might want this technology anyway? I mean,
that's the current situation.
Yeah.
I mean, a U.S. company is vulnerable to the grant of a compulsory license in every country in the world, which is why industry reacts so vehemently to any threat or indication that someone will issue a compulsory license, because they don't want this kind of general idea that countries can go ahead to do it to catch hold, and so every single instance becomes a potential trigger point of a wider use of that facility. But yes, I mean, that's the fact. Any government anywhere in the world at any time can issue a compulsory license on any ground that it chooses, and the recourse you have today is either to take that government, if it's a member of WTO, to WTO dispute settlement on grounds that it acted inconsistently with the TRIPS agreement, or if you're a bilateral agreement, that it acted inconsistently with the bilateral agreement, or if you really want to be novel, take them to the International Court of Justice under the Paris Convention. But I mean, that's really your options. There's no international supervisory authority responsible for controlling compulsory licensing.
Fred, you might add, I mean, the deal that Fred negotiated in the pharmaceutical sector, it was the waiver. You've heard us talk about the waiver. That is the possibility that a government that issues a compulsory license but does not have the manufacturing capacity can ask another government to issue a second compulsory license and manufacture the goods and export it and send it. And this is now international law, but only for pharmaceuticals. And it has only been used once. But in part, it's very complicated to use, but part, you haven't needed to use it until, because India until 2005 was not patenting pharmaceuticals, right? So it's only new stuff is going to be affected by it. So Fred did a paper, part of the paper that he gave today, but he did a paper for ICTSD on the feasibility of a similar system for climate change technologies, and it's a very good paper, and I think it looks at both sides. It's not totally optimistic and not totally pessimistic. You want to say a few words about your conclusions about the possibility of that?
No.
No. All right. Okay.
Other questions?
Regulatory system that wasn't mentioned, but is, you know, maybe a better balancing than compulsory licensing in terms of state intervention and market freedom, since collective licensing system allows to extend the binding obligation established in international agreements or company agreements to third parties. So.
You mean an extended license? Can you give us an example?
She is
here visiting from the Italian agency on digital copyright matters. Madam Mirlucci, your last name?
Yes, Marignello.
Okay, so tell us a little bit more about the extended license.
Well, collective licensing is a regulatory system spread out in Scandinavian countries in copyright field. Especially in corporate field, but the mechanisms is that in the market there are agreements between different economic actors, which allow for licensing in to fair use purposes. But under the law, the content of the agreement is extended to those companies or users who are not represented in the agreement.
I see.
So they get economics effective. Am I clear?
Yeah, but in other words, the collection society agreements that are distributing music, for example, and they can be and they're transnational. They're negotiated transnationally. Among the Scandinavian countries, and then all the member stakeholders can be held to those licenses, even though they weren't direct signatories to the negotiation.
Yeah,
but that would require an awful lot of Scandinavian countries are heterogeneous and they all like each other. It would require a higher level of international coordination than we can even think about at the moment, I think.
Well, but there is like compulsory patent pools.
But you have, I mean, today the one model that comes to mind, which I assume you're familiar with, is the Unitaid patent pool, which is in the process of formation. So, and there the idea is voluntary, you know, the holders of the patents contribute their licenses to the pool, then anybody, there's non-discriminatory access to the pool, and then that's being regulated by the independent pool entity and so forth. So, I mean, to the extent that's what you might be referring to as basically an open source license, you know, that idea is there, and I think that's what Jeanine's talking about too, in terms of what the companies are doing. It's voluntary contribution to a pool, right?
Essentially. Right. It sounds more like she was discussing that if there is some commercial agreement among multiple entities, that it becomes almost a compulsory pool, with that being the level of compensation or negotiation that it has come up to. So if four major players get together and make an agreement, then everyone else would be given benefit of that pool.
Yes, that's exactly what I was trying to talk about.
Yes, and I meant to say at the beginning, I hope that you'll also feel free to ask questions from Jennifer, our first speaker.
I think it was you who mentioned Bernice Lee in the Chatham House.
The new one
that came out this summer, where one of their main conclusions was that it takes so long
for
these patented technologies to come online. Do any of you have suggestions for why that, or just comment on why the process takes so long, and suggestions for needed technology, say for clean technology, ways to try to speed that process up, or is that just completely a factor of private sector incentives? In other words, if that's the problem, that we can't really look to the new technologies the way we'd like to,
well,
because it takes so long for them to actually get, once they're patented, to actually commercially scale.
We need Artie Rye for that, because the patent office had adopted a policy of expedited review, but part of the problem is that the nomenclature, what is an environmentally relevant technology. We don't have a classification for that. I understand that's one of the problems. So even all this patent landscaping that's going on takes forever as well, because they have to make all kinds of decisions about what is or what's not a relevant patent. I don't know how successful it's been. Do you know? Have they succeeded in expediting the review process?
I know they've expedited some reviews, but part of the problem there is that many times the commercial entity that's motivated to file the patent application isn't motivated to make it special and follow the process, because they are motivated to build up their own commercial capacity and make themselves be first to market.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So the motivation is not there, the reward mm-hmm. system is not there to give them the financial benefit of actually making them special and pushing them through, unless they believe there's a competitor breathing down their neck.
Now, let me just say, what does NIH do? And we hope NSF will catch up with them. NIH, you get a grant from NIH, you have to make the research results available. You really have to do it. And if you don't, you will never get another NIH grant. So that's what I mean. If you have, I mean, that speeds up research, okay, you got the patent. The patent is wending its way, but the blocking of the effects of the patent are much reduced if everybody out there knows the patent and knows where they can go to work around the patent. So you're speeding up the process. That's why I hope if we could get a transnational funding unit, but of course, footnote, as Fred says, well, will they now have the money? Well, you can and you should. We don't know. I mean, we don't know how it's going to be funded here. NSF has lagged behind, so you do not get the impetus to share research results from NSF that you do from NIH. We're hoping that they will improve. And then, no, DOE is good. DOE is big on sharing research results. Absolutely, we are partly funded by DOE, and we ourselves get every once in a while a prod in the back. but NSF lags behind, and we don't know how this stuff is going to be funded in the United States yet.
Well, and aren't U.S. patents published at 18 months, whether or not they've applied to become?
Worldwide,
unless you make an official statement that says you're not going to apply for patents outside the United States.
Let me just note, because maybe you know, Jennifer, is that, you know, when the Obama administration first announced its major funding for, you know, movement to green technologies, basically, you know, policies surrounding it was unstated, right? Who's going to have access to it, what we're going to do with it, are publicly funded technologies going to be made available more generally? I think I looked at this last, maybe November last year, and still had not seen anything the administration had done about trying to articulate a policy about what specifically would be done with the results of the investments in the, these large-scale investments. Is there a policy about that?
I don't know either. It's worth checking and seeing what's happened since, but I don't have an answer.
Because these are some, these are what John Barton was working on before he passed away, was you know, looking at the implications of these government-funded technology projects and what the United States, even internally, but more even externally, planned to do with it. If the government spends $5 billion on a new hybrid vehicle technology, is that $5 billion going to be held only by one company that does the R&D, or is it going to have to cross-license the technology throughout the industry? And Barton was thinking about that stuff pretty closely. There's some...
What a loss.
Okay. Are there other questions? Yes?
Seems like we're talking a lot about what happens after we develop the technology and then figure out who can use it. On the other end, have there been any efforts, maybe joint research agreements and things like that, to sort of get everybody together beforehand and let's all work on these new technologies that will be widely available when they come out? It seems like by sort of compartmentalizing all the R&D, everybody's hoping for the silver bullet that's going to save everybody or
Well, that's an interesting question. In the pharmaceutical sector, they've had some successes in the public partner, public-private partnerships. I'm thinking of Dindi, where they have tried to develop some malaria drugs, some neglected diseases by agreeing on pooling stuff from the beginning and so forth. I don't know. There's been, you hear talk about public-private the role, possible role of public-private partnerships in climate change technology, but I have no data about its actual happening.
Again, just looking back to Barton's work, Barton cited the example of a paradigm as the Semitech initiative back in the 80s, and that was when the major chip makers were going to contribute their technology to a pool and develop and manufacture, and he said that because this is important to this whole area, and I, one of the speakers mentioned it before, maybe Sarah, he said that what wasn't necessarily expected, but what happened was that the unintended consequence of establishing the pool was actually to reduce R&D directed to the objectives of the pool. Because each of the acting companies assumed that they could free ride on the R&D efforts of the others. So I'm not saying that that isn't a good idea, but I'm saying that it's not self-evident that telling a group of companies that they have to contribute the results of their R&D into a pool necessarily is the best way to stimulate innovation that can actually have a different result.
Of NSF, there's just not enough money for initiative to do it there.
Are there other questions?
Jonathan. Well, I'm just, first of all, very much enjoyed the panel and comments. Wondering whether, in looking at what you called emerging or major developing countries that are starting to develop more of the innovations and inventions in the energy and green technology field, whether there's whether we can see changes in legal or policy rules or institutions that they have, or how have they used to motivate investment in not just the applications for patents, but because that's sort of self-reflecting evidence of the motivation to do that innovation. But there might be other policy or incentive effects as well, not only government funding, but prizes or others. And I'm wondering what they have, what Brazil or China or India or other such countries have taken from, not only from the experience not only of Japan, but also of Korea, Taiwan, Israel, other, what one might think of as countries bridging between developing and industrialized countries that have become enormous engines of startup enterprise and innovation.
Well, it's a very good question. China is in the lead, and China has just modernized its patent law, and it's put a lot of interesting provisions that cut both ways. It's tried to strike a better balance, I think, than some of the OECD countries, but at the same time, strongly incentivizing patents, and it has risen to, I think it is fourth or fifth now in climate change technology patents, and it's number one in solar. It's moving towards number one in solar, and moving towards number one in wind, and it's big in nuclear. It's done a number of things. It's improved its patent law, but on a very balanced basis, and it's spending a lot of government money, big time government money, and trying to get people there. Brazil is sort of all over the place. There's a lot of ferment in Brazil, and I think that they are very interested in a middle road patent law that is both incentivized and at the same time diffusion friendly. They're spending a lot of public money. There's a lot of problems in Brazil that as much as I could gather from a conference that I was at a few months ago, the number of, I think one of you mentioned it, I think Fred mentioned it, when you get between the top countries and the poor countries in this middle group, you can be amazed at how much capacity there is in some sectors, like aeronautics, right, in Brazil, and in other sectors in which they can be really behind. And the number of sectors doing effective investment can be, the number of firms doing effective investment in any given sector can be extremely low, and the amount of capital invested by the private sector can be amazingly low in certain sectors. But Brazil is big in biofuel, and I think the government is spending more and more money, and they're certainly getting geared up for it. So the statistic that caught my eye is the one I gave you. We're seeing 4,000 patents a year in these countries on average in this field. That's a lot. That is really a lot. So one thing or another, they're finding a way. I think it's probably a different way in each of these countries, but they are using a variety of techniques.
Good. And I agree with what Jerry just said, that each of those countries has its own unique kind of government policy mix. Brazil, the Brazilian National Development Bank, BNDES, has target sectors. So it typically is targeting four industrial policy sectors, and then in those industrial policy sectors develops a specific program, and the program will typically involve providing startup R&D funding, money for investing in facilities. Its latest innovation was to provide large-scale funding for mergers and acquisitions so that industries would have the financing to consolidate. But the national government is very active in promoting industrial policy once it selects a particular sector. I think India is a little less focused, but for example, in the pharmaceutical sector, it's recently established a system of national universities solely devoted to training graduate students in pharmaceutical technologies. So there's now eight, they're called NIPERS, which have, you know, do nothing but feed into the pharmaceutical sector. I don't think they're at the same place with the energy sector there. But so these governments are giving these things a lot of thought. IP is part of the mix in all of these, as Jerry said. both in Brazil and India, you have battles between kind of the nouveau innovators and the old school replicators, and everything tends to come out in the middle because you've got a kind of a power struggle between the two sides of industry in virtually all areas there.
It's interesting that China has been taking a fairly, I don't want to say aggressive, but at least a forward, it has positioned itself in the camp of internationally at the moment in the Copenhagen negotiations among those questioning the role of intellectual property, and at the same time it's pushing forward on all fronts and patenting like crazy. And I wish I knew whether that's just a negotiating strategy or what do you think?
I think it's a negotiating strategy. It's also that there's a whole geopolitical reason for them to try to maintain their role as the leader of the G77. Mm-hmm. So they're going to take on, for purposes of those negotiations, certain positions that are not necessarily completely international self-interest, because the broader interest of trying to hold that coalition together is important.
And what about poorer countries where there are very few? Professor Reichman talked in his talk about countries where there are just very few patents filed in this area. What sort of stance do they take on things like compulsory licenses?
They generally on this issue negotiate as a block called the G77. You definitely have the poorer countries more worried that they're being deprived of access to these technologies that they need. But a lot of them, frankly, are much more concerned about financing for adaptation than they are for them to get on the bandwagon of actually reducing their own emissions. And a lot of little poor countries have practically problem. So what they most need, frankly, is help with adaptation more than help with.
Are they going to get it? Did you come away optimistic or pessimistic about that?
About their getting money for adaptation?
Mm-hmm.
It remains to be seen how the countries who pledge to work toward $100 billion a year live up to that commitment, because a lot of that money is supposed to be for adaptation. But a lot of it's also supposed to come from the private sector. I'm quite pessimistic on significant short-term amounts of foreign aid in the area of adaptation. I think what you need to find are ways to make investment in adaptation commercially attractive, so that the private sector is going to
work. In private sector in those countries themselves.
In those countries themselves, mm-hmm. as well as for investors.
What about the deforestation? They were supposed to set up a huge fund for deforestation. Is that going to come up? Is that going
to
actually?
There's a commitment to start with, I think it's $3.5 billion for deforestation. And France and Norway are holding a meeting, I think, in a few weeks to start that process going. There's the forests are popular. There's I would say, a better chance of some financing for forests. And Norway had already done it. Contributed a lot to Brazil's Amazon fund and promised a lot of upfront money already for forests, and some other countries are following suit. But in the forestry, what they especially need is to build capacity for a lot of these countries to do the monitoring, the measuring, the assessing, and the forestry management of their own spot. Mm-hmm.
I think several of the panelists have talked about the difficulties with multilateral negotiations, and my question is, are there examples of bilateral negotiations that have been successful, or do you think that those types of negotiations could expand into something more?
Well, I would go back to one of the criteria that Fred listed for successful negotiations, which is how powerful you are. And a lot of bilateral negotiations are successful from the perspective of the powerful country. You know, it depends really on whether you're negotiating as equals, or, you know, if you're one country who's desperate to stay in the trade world, desperate for access to the U.S. market, they give away an awful lot in order to get that.
Well, I guess mm-hmm. that's a very good question, and I guess what the Copenhagen whatever it was, debacle or success, court demonstrates is, the question it poses is whether we're going to have a green room technique or not. Because that's how you got trade negotiations for a long, long time. We had a green room, now developing countries. A green room is where selected representative countries go into a room and negotiate for everybody else, and then when a deal is struck, then others more or less have to decide whether they're going to sign on to it or not, but can't be negotiated. It can't be significantly changed. And that has always been the foundation of multilateral trade, although now the poor countries hate it and have resisted it. This would be, you can see the Copenhagen as a start towards a green room. We're going to get some powerful countries together and some representative poor countries and cut a deal, because this can't work the way it's set up. And the only thing I can say is that it certainly could not work the way they had set up that conference. That can't work. That just can't work. But whether they will go to a green room or not, I don't know. China just sent a letter, I think yesterday, saying that it was not going to, that all negotiations had to continue under the established working committees, and they were not going to follow up this method.
But I think there are two slightly different questions. One is the Copenhagen Accord, if you view that as the green room process or not. And the other is, can you develop a green room process within the official UN negotiations? Because the Copenhagen Accord came out of a small group of countries, but it's viewed as illegitimate by some for different reasons.
What do you think? Do you think they could? I mean, I don't see how they're going to do it without developing some kind of a green room process. Can they do it?
Mexico is the incoming chair, is already talking about a process like that. I think the Danes thought that's what they were doing before Copenhagen, in bringing a smaller group of countries together called the Friends of the Chair, but they didn't get the political buy-in beforehand that would be considered a legitimate process. And then once everybody got there, China, even though it had been in the room, claimed that it was a secret process that they hadn't been part of. And so really, that's part of what turned countries so against the Danish Chair's text. But I think you look at, in the trade world, you had a green room in the past, and now it's getting harder and harder to do the trade deals, and I'm a little skeptical that the UN process can go in the opposite direction when the trade process seems to be going away. But I would also say that it's not entirely right to blame process reasons for Copenhagen's failure. I think there were not the elements of a deal to be had there. And if the major parties really had wanted a deal, they do have ways on leaning on some of the ones who were objecting that might have made it work better than it did. It's a very cumbersome, problematic process, but I wouldn't blame the lack of an outcome completely on the process.
Jennifer, I was wondering if you had any predictions about the U.S. cap and trade legislation for 2010.
On the president's desk by Memorial Day. It's a very difficult process right now. It's I think the odds are probably less than 50-50 that we'll get legislation this year, but it's hard to know what little thing might move it in the right direction. You know, the fact that the administration announced all this financial assistance for the nuclear industry this week shows that the administration is getting in and actively starting to deal in this area. They're looking for ways to work with the Republicans on this issue. And they only need five or six, I've lost count exactly, but they don't need that many Republicans to get to the 60 votes that they need to go forward. But it takes active involvement by the White House as well as leadership in the Senate. And I don't have a crystal ball, but I just know that everybody at EDF gets up and works as hard as they can every day on it anyway, because you have to be ready to grab the opportunity if it presents itself, because so much internationally hinges on the U.S. getting its own act together.
Are there other questions?
Slightly changing topics here, but I'd like to ask Professor Abbott, and it's, I suppose one could imagine that some green technologies could be reverse engineered, but it's specifically, could you talk to us a little bit about the generics in transit, and maybe a little bit about the relationship of GATT 5 and TRIPS on the freedom of transit?
Well, it is really not that complex a problem set in this regard. You start with the basic premise that it's a GATT article. Well, I'm saying you. I start with the premise that this is basically a GATT Article 5 case. For those of you who aren't familiar with the background, just in 30 seconds, about a year and a half, 2 years ago, there started to be a series of incidents in which Dutch customs authorities began to seize shipments of generic drugs that had been produced in India, where there was no patent on the drug, to other destinations where there was no patent on the drug, on the basis of a patent held by a pharmaceutical manufacturer in the Netherlands. And the typical way the process works is that a Dutch patent owner will notify customs of its patent and request that the shipment be seized, and then that would take place, and then there's correspondence with the patent owner, et cetera. This is based on a 2003 regulation of the European Community, which appears to authorize that insofar as it subjects goods passing through customs holding zones to intellectual property claims under national law, however that might be defined. The European Court of Justice in the Montex case and others has said that to the extent your goods aren't intended to enter the EC market, there is no basis for seizure or detention, but a Dutch patent course in a case called Sosical v. Sisal applied something called a manufacturing fiction, which is in a preamble of the regulation, and the preamble to the regulation says that for the purposes of applying national intellectual property law, you may assume that the act complained of takes place in the country under which the seizure occurs. So the court said, we know that these goods aren't manufactured in the Netherlands, but under the recital manufacturing fiction, we are going to pretend that the goods were manufactured in the Netherlands. And if they were manufactured in the Netherlands, then there would have been an infringement cause of action by the Dutch patent holder, and therefore the goods can be seized, detained, destroyed, et cetera. Now, GATT Article 5 establishes a basic principle called freedom of transit. And freedom of transit says that the customs authorities of a country do not have the right to impose any unnecessary and unreasonable restraints on the passing of goods through the country in transit. And so the fundamental question at issue is whether applying a local patent to a good merely because it is passing through Schiphol Airport constitutes a reasonable exercise of Dutch regulation on those goods. And up until a year ago in the Panama Indicative Prices case, there was virtually no precedent on GATT Article 5. But now there is a very strong interpretation by a GATT panel that freedom of transit must be construed strictly. The problem, but so assume that India will base its complaint on GATT Article 5 and freedom of transit. The European Community will defend the case on the grounds, particularly of Article 51 of the TRIPS Agreement, and I don't want to take anyone's brain too far in technicalities at such an early stage in the morning, but Article 51 establishes an obligation to apply border measures in respect to trademark counterfeit and copyright pirated goods, and allows the application of border measures with respect to other types of IP infringement.
and includes a footnote, footnote 13, that says there shall be no obligation to apply these measures in respect to goods first placed on the market in another country or to goods in transit. Well, one of the issues in the case is what was implied.